new beginnings are exciting for anybody. And we'll have a lot more congregational participation in music. We'll have some more instruments, I think, perhaps tonight already. Someone said they might come and bring an instrument. We're going to have just a good, old-fashioned, if I could use that term, evangelistic rally. And I want to share a message that is designed for reaching people for Christ and bring some unsaved people. I promise you it won't be dead, okay? And it won't be boring. And it'll be exciting as the Lord provides. We've been singing for 24 years and always knew for sure from times in my late teens where God eventually was going to have me. But I wanted to be in His timing, and what our visions and our goals are, we'll share with you as time goes on.
Sometimes I feel discouraged. Sometimes my life seems so hard. Monday and Tuesday, they get me down. And by Wednesday, I'm feeling tired. The world and the flesh and the devil will nag me and wear me down. Only the fellowship of God's real people will cheer me up and lift my frown.
So let us encourage each other in the Lord. Encourage each other.
Fellowship fills me with feelings of love. It makes me long for that precious day we will gather up above. But now I'm so happy. I am stronger for all your care. Let's lift our voices and praise God in song. And don't forget each other in prayer.
And now I'm feeling mighty fine. Well, I'm feeling mighty fine.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome again to the Good News Break. This is JR Damiani, pastor of Family Worship Center just outside of Lansdale, Pennsylvania, and happy to come your way this July Sunday morning with the Good News Break. And I hope you stay with us. Leave the dial where it is, turn it up loud in the house or in the car. Don't let anybody sleep during the Good News Break. And these are troublesome times. Troublesome times are here. But I love what Jesus says to his disciples. In this world, you will have troubles, tribulation, but be of good cheer, or cheer up. I have overcome the world, and I hope you're cheerful today. The 15th, is that a
March.
Sunday?
Mm-hmm.
That'll be our last Good News Break here on WNPV. So we're kind of retiring from that. And whatever the Lord has after that on WNPV. It's been a great ride. I loved it.
Here's an old song by the Kingsmen. I know you'll enjoy it. It's called Cheer the Weary Traveler.
I love this one.
God bless you all.
Weary traveler, let us cheer the weary traveler. Let us cheer the weary traveler along the heavenly road.
Good afternoon. Thank you so much, each and every one of you, for coming out. It means the world to our family, and I know my dad loved you so much, and thank you for being here to support us, and we really appreciate every person that's here. If we didn't greet you yet, we hope to before the night's over, each and every one of you. We love you very much. Relax this afternoon. I'm used to being evening, right? It's afternoon so far. But relax. It's going to be music, some sharing, some memories, and more music. So settle in and just enjoy it and cry with us and laugh with us. And this will be a send-off that we wanted to do so much in December and weren't able to, but we're so blessed that we were able to do it tonight. If you don't know who I am, maybe some of you don't, I'm David Damiani, JR's son, and there's five kids in the family, Becky, Marie, Chrissy, then me, then 10 and a half years later, Jonathan. And I'm sure when you saw the pictures, you were like, who's that little boy? That can't be David because he's the oldest, isn't he? He looks so old. No, I'm not really the oldest. I just look old. It just happened. I don't know what happened, but so we're all here, all the siblings, all the kids, all the grandkids, we're all here, and we're just thankful for you. And I just want to open with a word of prayer. I was going to tell a JR joke, but I paused and hesitated. I don't know where you all are from, so on the count of three, yell out what town you're from. Remember, you would always do that. One, two, three. What would he say then? Oh, I got it. Anyway, <yeah. laughs> we've been blessed. We're blessed. I'll tell you one thing out of the gate. I'm the pastor here now of the church, and I spent the last 2 years with my dad every day here at the church, offices next to each other, and it was a blessing. Of course, I've been his son a long time, but the last 2 years, it was awesome to be with him every day. And I will say, I'm here. I walk the halls he walked, and I will say, I say to myself all the time when I think about it, he is happy. Very happy right now. My dad is very happy. I don't feel sorry for him or sad for him because he's thrilled. He sang about heaven for 100 years and now he's there. I feel, of course, we feel sad of the loss, but I feel really blessed and happy for him. So let's pray together. Father, thank you. We are here in this building because of your glory, Lord, because of your favor, because of your love for us, because of your grace. Lord, thank you for so many years, Lord, 79 years we had with our dad. Thank you for 36, 37 years that he was here at this church, pastoring faithfully week after week after week. Lord, thank you that for all the recordings we have and his voice. Thank you, Lord, for the memories. Thank you for the lives that he touched that are here in this room today, that all loved him and that he loved so much. Lord, thank you for the years that we had with him. Lord, I just pray for this night that you are glorified, that your Holy Spirit is felt and present. Holy Spirit, we give you freedom tonight. Do a work. Do a work in each of us. Do a deeper work. Help us grow a little closer, more Christ-like, even through this night. Even through remembering the life of J.R. Damiani, Father, that it would draw us to be a little more like Jesus. We follow his example as he followed Christ. Lord Jesus, we love you. In Jesus' name, amen. So, Becky Marie Chrissy, Chrissy's third daughter. You all know Becky and Marie because they sing. Chrissy, third daughter. Her son, Evan, is coming up right now. Evan Floyd.
everybody. Like my Uncle Dave said, my name's Evan, for those of you that don't know me. I was asked to read the obituary, probably because I have no musical gifts at all. Thanks, Terrell. So here we go. Pastor J.R. Damiani, 79, of Waxhaw, entered into his eternal home Monday, December 14th, 2020. He was the beloved husband of Beverly Collins Damiani, his wife of 58 years. Born on February 6, 1941 in Waxhaw, where he lived all of his 79 years, J.R. was a son of the late Alfred, an Italian immigrant from Popoli, Italy, and his wife Mary LeBou Damiani. J.R. worked in the family trade as a shoe cobbler at Al's Shoe Center in Lansdale for many of his early years. At a very young age, he ran the store when his dad left for extended times to preach and evangelize. J.R. ended up leaving high school early to work full-time at the store shop to help the family make ends meet. J.R. was known by all as a powerful man of God who gave his life in service to the gospel of Jesus Christ. He began his life in public ministry at the age of 19 when he began traveling and evangelizing throughout the Northeast with his gospel quartet, the Eastmen. Throughout his years in his music industry, he recorded 29 albums, traveled with various forms of the group all over the United States, including Canada and the Caribbean, and reached countless lives for Jesus. JR always felt a call to ministry and considered his time ministering in churches and concert venues to be his training ground for his life as a pastor. Over the years, JR supplemented his income by selling real estate and running an Italian sub shop. He put his whole heart into whatever his hands found to do. JR had an incredible work ethic and a servant's heart. In 1948, JR and his wife Beverly were called to a new phase of ministry as they planted Family Worship Center, which continues to be a thriving church in the greater Philadelphia area. Pastor JR served faithfully until his retirement in January of 2020, when he passed on the pastoral mantle to his son, David. JR loved the people of FWC with all the love he had, which was a considerable amount. He was proud of the work God led him to accomplish, and his church community rejoices that he is finally reaping his reward in heaven. JR was known to many as a talented musician and a dedicated pastor of his flock. But more than this, he was a beloved father, grandfather, great-grandfather, brother, and uncle. Those who know him best will forever remember his quick wit, his infectious laugh, his kind heart, his love of classic cars, his occasional skill on the golf course, and his love for hunting and the outdoors. You can count yourself as blessed if you had the chance to sit with him and his wife Beverly at their kitchen table, talking about whatever came to mind. In his later years, he loved to reminisce about his quartet days, his favorite cars, his family and friends, and more than anything, the love he had for his family. In addition to his wife, he is survived by his children, like Uncle Dave said, Becky, her husband John of Harleysville, Marie Humphrey, her husband Kent of Bowling Green, Kentucky, Chrissy, my mother, and my dad, Nelson III of Waxhaw, Uncle Dave, his wife Heather, also of Waxhaw, and Uncle John Damiani of Pasadena, California. 10 grandchildren, 12 great-grandchildren, two sisters, Betty Miller and Uncle Pete of Waxhaw, and Lilia Tita Schaefer, also of Waxhaw, and a brother, Timothy Damiani, and his wife Wendla of Milford, PA. He was preceded in death by his five brothers, Ellis, Victor David, Paul, Peter, and John. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. We're so glad that you're here, and especially those who've traveled. We were thrilled to see so many of you who came a distance, and it just means the world to us. We're going to sing together. We're going to just sing some songs that were favorites of Dad's. Of course, he loved to lead the congregation in singing. And so we're going to just make up a heavenly sounding choir. And I think he'll hear us if we sing loud enough, but passionately enough. If you sing from your heart and your soul, I think it will reach the portals of heaven. Beautiful. Thank you. We need to do one more. Every time we had a concert, Dad just wanted to hear this building filled and enjoy the acoustics of this building and listen to the congregation sing a cappella. Let's sing one verse of Amazing Grace. Very beautiful, beautiful. We are going to sing one more song. And Dad is going to lead us. One of his favorite singer-songwriters was Stuart Hamlin. And he loved this song that Stuart wrote called It Is No Secret. Sing together.
It is no secret what God can do.
First met you as a singer when I was just 16. You took the time to share with me the reason why you sing. You said the road's not always easy, but God is ever true. You said just share the good things that he has done for you. You became my hero of the faith, soldier of the cross, singing out the grand old story, Jesus saves the lost. And now it's time to lay your armor down and pass the torch, but you're a hero of the faith, soldier of the cross. I just got the news this morning that you had slipped away. It seemed my heart was broken. It couldn't end this way. But then I saw with spirit eyes the entrance you must have made, running to the arms of Jesus, finally home to stay. With other heroes of the faith, soldiers of the cause, singing out the grand old story, Jesus saves the lost. And even though you've laid your armor down and passed the torch, you are heroes. The cross.
Amen. My hero was born with music in his blood. And it's something that God had planned for him early on. If it wasn't for music, he wouldn't have met my mom. And I don't know where I would be today. So I'm so thankful for the love that my dad had for gospel music. Some of my fondest memories as a child were going to sleep listening to the Eastmen Quartet practice in the living room. They would literally sing me to sleep. And they were some of my heroes from early on because they were a part of our family. My dad, like, family was big to him. And so the quartet men were his family and their wives were our family as well. I remember how devastated I was the day I found out that Uncle Ronnie Landis was not my blood uncle, because we called him Uncle Ronnie and I thought he was my uncle for real. But he really was, because it was the blood of Jesus that drew us together. So when we were talking about this night, we knew that music had to be a part of it. And we were so very, very thankful that Danny and Jim and Joe and Frank were able to come here to sing some old Eastmen songs. We've cried many, many tears yesterday just hearing the songs. It takes us back. But you know, music started in my dad at birth, I believe. And music was what kept him going even to his last days. He would call my mom while he was in the hospital because we couldn't go in and see him, and he'd call her 11, 12 times a day, and every time she'd say hello, he'd start singing a song. It was always in his blood, and we just want to honor him tonight and listen to the Eastmen Quartet. I know some of you are here that have been going to concerts all of your lives, and you can't wait to hear these wonderful men, my heroes, that taught me a lot about Jesus just by the way that they lived their lives. So welcome the Eastmen Quartet.
Thank you. is wonderful. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord, He is the mighty King, Master of everything. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord.
He's the great Shepherd, the Rock of all ages.
Almighty God, is He. Bow down before Him.
The Rock of all ages.
Almighty God, is He. Bow down before Him.
I'm looking out over this audience and I've seen a few faces in back when you were coming in and recognized a lot, but it's been quite a few years since I've seen most of the people, or a lot of the people that I sang to many years ago. My start came as a gospel singer through JR. First met him when I was in Bible college, didn't know his name, didn't know who he was. I had to ask people, but I became friends with him and never knew that I would sing with him someday in a group, but it's a pleasure to be here with you to celebrate our brother.
I was drifting away on life's pitiless sea when an angry wave threatened my
save. Then trust Him today no longer delay, for the old ship of Zion and a shout on your way. Jesus saves.
This song takes me way back. Number one, the reason why I got to join the Eastmen was I have a brother, I don't know if you know, his name's Neil. And he called up JR and he said, I have a brother that can sing tenor. Now, he's not too sharp, but he has potential. So, anyway, I got started there. And this was on the first full album that I recorded with the Eastmen. And I remember 11 years ago at the Eastmen reunion, I told JR, you never tell JR anything, told JR, if you expect to wait another 10 years to do another reunion, don't expect me to sing Ship Ahoy. He just smiled. You know that smile, don't you? Like, and JR is still smiling today. Praise the Lord. Amen. Yes.
I'm so glad that Darrell here is ready to help me out, because I forget how that song went on the piano. And he remembered and he didn't even play it. So, and you notice we're not wearing ties. When JR was on the platform, we wore ties. He's not here.
You'll get you.
The time we will have when we cross the mystic foam. What a time we will have over there. When the saints of all ages are gathered home. What
amazing grace will be heard everywhere.
What a time we will have when we see Jesus Christ. What a time we will have over there. What a time we will have when we reach that far land. What a time we will have over there. When the singer shall join in that heavenly band. What a time we will have over there.
Thank you, Uncle Frank. There's a nice seat for you for just a second. I'm going to sing with the Eastmen. I'm going to sing with the Eastmen. I always sang with them anyway because I knew every song, didn't we? Every song, every part. We could give them the lyrics if they didn't know it. And, but the problem is, Danny has not lost his range. He's up there, and I did. So this is, we're gonna be in competition here. But we're gonna sing a song that Joe wrote. He wrote many, and this one was actually a special request by our brother David.
The pastor tells you to sing it, you sing it.
That's right, exactly.
Lord, we pray for those around us who from their birth have been in sin, and now for years they have been shackled. For those in strength, break the chain. Lord, we pray for our own loved ones who at this time are lost in sin. And now we lift them up in faith believing. Touch them today, dear God, and break the chain. Break the chains that bind the sinner.
I was 14, 13 years old when my dad stopped singing, I think, and my whole life, we call these guys our uncles because, like Marie said, we thought they were. So, you wrote that song, right? So I'm like, Uncle Frank said he started in the group when he was 1973, I was 4 years old. So somewhere around 7, 8, you don't even remember, he didn't even remember the song. I was 7, 8 years old, 9 years old, sitting in the concert and heard that song, and I never forgot it in all my life. And when they were going to sing, I said, I love that song, Break the Chains. I remember they were like, what song, Break the Chains? What are you talking about? I never forgot it. So bring your kids to church. Bring them to concerts. You know, it makes an effect on them. Break the chains that bind the sinner. Amen?
It's powerful. Does Jesus care when my heart is pained too deeply for mirth and song, as the burdens press and the cares distress and the way grows weary
and long. Does Jesus care when I've said goodbye to the dearest on earth to me? And my sad heart aches till it nearly breaks. Is it all to him? Does he see? His heart is touched by my grief. When the days are weary, the long night dreary, I know my Savior. Is touched by my grief. When the days are weary, the long night weary, I know
Reach out.
There are so many stories that we could tell of our friend, our boss, but mostly Fred, over the years, and it would be depicted in maybe one or two words. One of them is real. The other is consistent. What you saw in JR, or in JR when he was here at the pulpit, was the same thing you got when you were on the bus with him, or whether you were his son or daughter. It was him. He didn't change. He used to say, when we were in concert sometimes, he says, you know, you need to just be yourself. Because if you're something different, the next time you come back, you may forget who you were. Now that's good, isn't it? And he was that. He was real. And now we're going to sing a song that talks about the blessed hope that every one of us that knows Jesus as our Savior has. And he's already experiencing. He's experiencing the joy and the hope. And the older I get, the more I can't wait to be there. 10,000 years.
Soon I'll come to the end of my journey, and I'll meet the one who gave his life for me. I will thank him for the love that he gave me. And 10,000 years and more I'll reign with him.
10,000 years will just be started. 10,000 years will just begun. The battle's over.
Begin to sing love's sweet story. It's a song that the angels cannot sing. Oh, I'm redeemed by the blood of my Savior. And 10,000 years and more I'll praise his name.
10,000 years will just be started. 10,000 years we've just begun. The battle's over and the victory's won.
That's not bad for a bunch of 30-year-olds, is it?
That was beautiful. Thank you so much for sacrificing your time and for coming. And you sound as good as you ever did, guys. And we mean that because we see your heart. And I'm excited that in the very near future, we will have a YouTube channel. We're going to call it Everything Eastmen. And we're well on our way to making it happen. And you will be able to listen to every single album and song that the Eastmen ever recorded. And it's going to be wonderful. I've been enjoying listening. I kind of got, you know, the all of the music ahead of time, thanks to our friend Barry Schneck. Thank you, Barry. It's wonderful. And so we're looking forward to enjoying that music. I don't know, just every once in a while maybe check YouTube and just put in Everything Eastmen and see if it's up yet, because I don't know when it will be. But we thought we'd sing a song that the Eastmen family sang, because after the Eastmen Quartet disbanded, we traveled as a family group for 5 years, and Darrell joined us, and Johnny Brittingham, he's in heaven. And so we sang 5 years, and then we started the church in 1984. So we're gonna sing one. Yep. Do you want to say anything? We'll sing. Okay. So this guy here is singing Dad's part. This is Kent. You all know that, right? This is Marie's husband, Kent. All right, we're gonna sing Feeling Fine. We're gonna sing how Dad's feeling right now.
Woke up this morning feeling fine. I woke up with heaven on my mind. I woke up with joy in my soul, for I knew the Lord had control, and I knew I was walking in the light, for I'd been on my knees in the night, and I prayed till the Lord gave a sign. Walking with Jesus all the time. We're walking and talking as we climb. We're traveling the road to the sky, where I know I'll live when I die.
He's been telling me all about that land,
and he tells me that everything is grand, and he says that a home will be mine. And now I'm feeling fine.
Well, I'm feeling mighty fine.
Yes, I'm feeling fine.
I've got heaven on my mind.
Don't you know?
I wanna go.
Where
the milk and honey
flow.
There's a light
that always shines
down inside
this heart of mine.
This heart of mine. I've got heaven on my mind.
Fine.
Yes, I'm feeling mighty fine.
Yes,
I've got heaven on my mind. Don't you know?
I wanna go.
Yes, I
wanna
go.
Where the milk
and honey flow. There's a light
that always shines
down inside
this heart of mine.
I've got heaven on my mind.
Feeling fine.
That's for you, Daddy.
Death is nothing at all. I have only slipped away to the next room. I am I, and you are you. Whatever we were to each other, that we still are. Call me by my old familiar name. Speak to me in the easy way which you always used. put no difference in your tone. Wear no forced air of solemnity or sorrow. Laugh as we always laughed at the little jokes we enjoyed together. Play, smile, think of me. Let my name be ever the household word that it always was. Let it be spoken without effect, without the trace of a shadow on it. Life means all that it ever meant. It is the same as it ever was. Why should I be out of mind? Because I am out of sight. I am but waiting for you. Somewhere. Very near. Just around the corner. All is well.
Extended family asked if they could speak, and this is when we're going to have you all say something. So, Uncle Timmy?
Well, Becky, I don't know who planned all this, but thank you so much. It's such a wonderful thing, and I miss my brother JR so much. So, thank you all for this wonderful send-off. And the music.
Yes. Amen. Wow. We've already had such a wonderful concert and remember our brother, JR. And as you've already been told several times, we're here to celebrate his life and his graduation into the presence of the living God, whom he served very faithfully. You know that, and we know that. Now, there are reasons for how his life developed and what he was able to do for the kingdom of God in service to the Lord, both through music and through the word. What are those reasons? Did you ever think of the reasons why people do and accomplish the things that they do? Well, in our family, we have to look back to our parents and the heritage that they have given to us. And parents today need to realize and look ahead that your children are you are building a heritage for your children as well. Our parents were great examples before us. They set the example of how to live, how to behave, what to do. But most of all, they built a foundation for us in the Word of God and in prayer. And that was a primary part of our lives, not only as we went faithfully to church, but also in the home. We were reading scripture and praying as a family. And that foundation that they laid in each of our lives and in JR's life is the reason for what he has accomplished to the glory of God. He built upon that foundation through the power of the Holy Spirit, who led him and guided him. And he, the Lord Jesus Christ, through his Holy Spirit, wants to lead and guide every one of us. And as our parents left a legacy in the Word of God for us, parents today need to leave that legacy in the lives of their children. And even as JR has left a legacy of his life in his children, and it's very, very obvious. And not only that legacy grows within us, that's also why we are a close family today. And we all honor and thankful for our own parents over the years. Gradually, by the direction of the Holy Spirit, JR birthed and established this church in this community. And he gave all the credit and the thanks to the living God, not to himself, as we'll see what I can do. No, he gave all the thanks and the credit to the living God and thanked him for calling him, not only through music, but also through the preaching of the word. And now his commission has been fulfilled. But although his commission is fulfilled, that is not the end. He leaves the work that is unfinished for all of us to do. His ministry must continue through those who are still here, not only through his own family, but through all of those who have been touched by his ministry, not only in music, but in the Word of God. Those who have had the life and the light of the Word delivered to them through the preaching of the Word, that has to grow and shine through you to other people. And he would say to you and to I tonight, continue. Continue the work. His commission is complete, but ours is not. And all of you here who have received the presence of the Lord in your life, who have committed your life to him and have a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, go, continue. Let your light shine and bring life and light to others around you. So all of us have to continue. JR would say, to God be the honor and the glory and the praise, not to him, but to God. So let us all continue and go and be the light that he wants us to be.
My daughter Leah, my husband Johnny, and our daughter Hannah. Our son-in-law Ben is running sound. You'll hear from him in a little bit. And we have four grandsons. Living with a dad like ours was a daily adventure. He loved life. He loved his Lord. He loved his family. He loved his work. He found joy in every day. He was the most consistent, joyful, fun, silly, kind, thoughtful, godly, loving man I've ever known. And he was so handsome. I wondered if Dad might be upset if we seemed too heavy-hearted today. He was always about disarming people with humor, making people laugh. He was always encouraging people. He wanted to be the one who gave them hope and a helping hand. His philosophy in life was positivity, Even his blood type was B positive. But to lose someone who was bigger than life, our go-to guy, our rock, his absence is keenly felt. He was a giant among men. He was our hero, our greatest role model. I suppose it's natural to feel a bit lost without him. No one is perfect, but he came pretty close. We really connected with the poem that we used in the last video because it rang true. He is just around the corner. He showed us the way, and then he went on ahead. He used to say he wanted to have such a close walk with the Lord that one day as they walked together in sweet fellowship, Jesus would say, "JR, we're closer to my house than yours. Why don't you come home with me?" And that's exactly what happened.
Hello, my name is Hannah Randall now. I was Pop-Pop's first granddaughter, and I didn't know how special that was for a long time, but I'm honored, but it's also a responsibility, and it's, the Lord knows when you're supposed to be placed on this earth, and there's a reason for it. There's a reason that you're in the place that you're at, and I'm very grateful for the example that my grandfather left, and I love what Aunt Betty said, because it brings it back to the truth that this is not about putting a person up where they're not supposed to be or idolizing someone. It's about recognizing who he was always pointing to and continuing to worship just in person. And so that's what this all comes back to, is the Lord, because he is the only constant one. People will fail. People will disappoint. People will do wrong by you. But God will never fail you. And that he is a rock you can cling to. And that's who Pop-Pop clung to. So that is just, I'm so grateful for that experience. This is a song we're going to sing that was requested by Grandma. And just like whatever the pastor says you sing, whatever the matriarch of the family once heard, you sing it. But it's in honor of Pop-Pop because we know this is how he lived his life. Do you
know? While the world looks upon me as I struggle along, they say I have nothing, but they are so wrong. In my heart I'm rejoicing, how I wish they could see. Thank you, Lord, for your blessing on me. There's a roof up above me, I've a good place to sleep. There's food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. Though I'm not wealthy, and these clothes, they're not new, don't have much money, but Lord, I have you, and that's all matters, though the world may not see. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. There's a roof up above me, I've a good place to sleep. There's food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord,
fine family. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me.
If you know the words, feel free to sing along.
There's a roof up above me. I've a good place to sleep. There's food on my table and shoes on my feet. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me. You gave me your love, Lord, and a fine family. Thank you, Lord, for your blessings on me.
I've got the Bible, but that doesn't mean I'm going to be long. I know this is a little bit later than we anticipated, but I just wanted to share what God's been dealing with me through the death of my dad. Wow. I keep thinking if I don't say it, it really didn't happen. My hero, my rock, my daddy, my pastor, my boss, everything that you ever have in life, it seems like was wrapped up in that man. And I remember so vividly, I was a little bit of an insecure little girl. And I remember Daddy took me for a walk because he knew I was struggling and trying to find my place. And he told me, he said, "You know, Ree, God made you." "I know, Daddy. God don't make junk. And God made you just the way he wanted you to be, and there's a reason for that." And as I was processing over the last 6 months, grief is not a fun thing, and I don't like grief at all, right? It's hard to process. But I was reading in the book of Kings, and I was reading about King Josiah, and this verse just jumped out at me. "Now before him, there was no king like him who turned to the Lord with all of his heart, with all of his soul, and with all of his might, according to all of the law of Moses. Nor after him did any arise like him." And immediately my heart just went to my dad. Like, there was none like him in my life. And I said, "So if there was no one else like him after that, God, what does that mean for me?" You know, we all have a footprint in this world, and Aunt Betty said it beautifully too. God doesn't make junk. And I want to pattern my life after my dad because he patterned his life after the Word of God. And I can't be my dad, but I can be me and be the person God created me to be and have that footprint where when it comes to the end of my life, there is no one like her. She followed after God with all of her heart and all of her mind and all of her soul and all of her strength. And that, I believe, is what my dad would want to say to me, as he did when I was a little girl, and what he would want to say to you. There's none like you. You're here for a reason. You're here on purpose. And be who God created you to be. Uncle Joe, I can't tell you how many times I remember my dad saying that to me when we would sing, "Just be you, Marie. Then you don't ever have to remember who you were the next time you come." Be who God created you to be. And my prayer is that from this night forward, you'll go and say, "God, what is it that you want me to do? May I pattern my life after what you created me to do?" So there'll be none like me that ever comes after me. I just want to encourage you in the Lord, because my dad, that's all he did was encouraged. He encouraged everybody. The guy at the pizza shop
his cleaner. They were like BFFs. And anybody he ran into, I remember we would be on the bus and we'd go through the turnpike when there was people allowed to take your tickets, right? And you go through the turnpike and you take your tickets and you give them the money. And my daddy would always say, you know, Jesus loves you. I just wanted to let you know that Jesus loves you. And as a little girl, I just wanted to curl under the seat, you know. Dad, really? Everybody? Yes, everybody. He encouraged everybody, everywhere he went. And this right here is an example of his life lived for God. And I know the end of his life was not what we wanted it to be. But I know one thing for sure, Jesus was with him every step of the way. When I cried out to God and said, God, I don't understand. Why can't we go be with Daddy in the hospital? I just felt God's peace because he was with him. And he's with us tonight. He's in us. He's here. And he wants to encourage your heart tonight so that tomorrow your life will not be the same. Daddy always said, if we've come and we've heard and we leave and we're not changed, then our coming is in vain. So let's not let this night be in vain. Let the Holy Spirit of God do a work in our heart and a healing work in our heart and make the Lord happy and my daddy proud. Amen.
Amen. Well, I'm Kent Marie's husband. This is our son Jordan, and his wife Jenny is here, and our three grandchildren, Harrison, Bo, and Leland are here. Our daughter Emily and her husband Marcus couldn't be here tonight. They're in Tennessee, but just wanted to take just a second. JR and I had a different relationship. I was I knew him since 1982 when I met Marie, and no matter when we got together, wherever it was, we talked about two things: golf and gospel music. And it didn't matter if we told the same stories. Every time we got together, he would laugh just as hard about the same stories and tell it like it was the very first time they ever told it. And so we had a lot of moments like that over coffee, telling stories about the road days and all the things that happened. He also had an affectionate name for everybody, and he had one for me, and it was Horseface. And I learned to love it, embrace it, and just know it was going to happen. And even if I wasn't here and he was on the radio, he was probably going to say it anyway. He also told Marie, he told me, Marie always wanted to marry someone half the man that I was, and that's exactly what she got. But I say tonight, if I'm half the man that he was, I'm okay with that.
I'm going to sing a hymn that I remember hearing Pop-Pop sing occasionally in his office, specifically The Old Rugged Cross. I was going to sing it at his funeral, and it did not get a chance to happen, so I was grateful that Becky and Grandma asked me to sing for you today. Down.
attraction for me. For that old rugged cross left his glory above to bear it on dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a so divine, a wondrous beauty I see. On that old rugged cross, Jesus suffered and died to pardon and sanctify me. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay. For a crown to that old rugged cross, I will ever be true. Its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share.
I'm the third daughter. I'm Chrissy, my son Nelson. Evan, you heard from earlier, and my daughter's here, and my grandkids, and my husband. And we want to thank you for being here. I got to take my glasses off to read. I'm my father's daughter. I did write this one out this time because I didn't know how emotional I was going to be. So thank you all for coming today to help us honor our father's life. 2020 was a difficult year for all of us in so many ways, and losing our dad was a very hard end to a very long year. But in our time of great sorrow, the Lord was so close, and we all felt his presence and your prayers. I'm so very grateful for the legacy of faith that our parents instilled in us that we can draw on in times of great sorrow and uncertainty. Music was a huge part of my dad's life, particularly Southern gospel music. It was the soundtrack to our lives. My dad sang in the Eastmen Quartet from the time he was 19, and he was also a concert promoter. In fact, the night that I was born, April 23rd, 1966, my dad was at a concert at Souderton High School because I was born back in the archaic times of them not allowing a father to be present at the birth. So my mom was at the hospital and my dad was at a concert. I think Aunt Norma maybe took her to the hospital. Not sure. That's what I remember hearing anyway. 3 years later, to the day, my brother David was born. So my dad started the tradition for many years to come of promoting a concert in April. Many times, David and I were serenaded on our birthday by George Jantz of the Cathedral Quartet. He sang either Jesus, I Heard You Had a Big House, or the Laughing Song. And I remember being brought out on the stage and sitting on the piano and being sung to, and it was such fun. And then we went running off and doing our thing. But we went to a lot of concerts. Because my dad was a concert promoter, he had a lot of albums sent to him in the mail of up-and-coming artists. And when I was around 15 years old, an album came with the title, My Father's Eyes, by a new young artist called Amy Grant. I fell in love with that album and with the title song, and in fact, I still have that album somewhere. The words to that song say, I may not be every mother's dream for her little girl, and my face may not grace the mind of everyone in the world, but that's all right, as long as I can have one wish, I pray. When people look inside my life, I want to hear them say, she had her father's eyes, eyes that find the good in things when good is not around, eyes that find the source of help when help cannot be found, eyes full of compassion, seeing every pain, knowing what you're going through, and feeling it the same, just like my father's eyes. My dad was full of compassion, and he always wanted to find the positive out of any situation. And he used to say, like Becky said, that his outlook on life was like his blood type, be positive. He was the kind of person who would give you the shirt off his back. If you needed something and he had it, or it was within his power to get it for you, he would. He lived every day to be like Jesus. Today is Father's Day, and I know for some it can be a very hard day because they either never had a father in their life or their father has passed away, and this is our first Father's Day without our dad, and I do miss him terribly. And I work with many young women in my position at Morningstar Maternity Home who never had a father in their lives. But it is our hope and prayer through that ministry that we can introduce them to our Heavenly Father who loves them immensely. It is not lost on me that I was so blessed to have had an earthly father who strove every day to emulate his Heavenly Father. He truly walked the walk. One of the greatest joys in his life was to lead someone to the saving knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus and to introduce them to our Heavenly Father. If you are here today and you have never given your heart to the Lord, it would be our greatest honor to know that through our words and the music from this celebration of our dad's life, that you would reach out to Jesus and begin to know him in a personal way. Taking the time this week to once again look at pictures and share memories of my dad's life, well lived, has solidified the hope in me that when my life is over and people gather to remember me, they can say, she had her father's eyes. It is so worth it to live your life for the Lord.
Hello. I can kind of see why Papa liked being up here. I have all of your attention. Thank you all for being here today to honor and celebrate the life of JR Damiani. My name is Nelson, and I am JR and Beverly's oldest grandchild, oldest son of Chrissy and Nelson. I originally wrote this remembrance eulogy the week that JR passed from this life and into his greatest adventure yet. That was a hard week for our family. There was and continues to be many unexpected challenges and unordinary circumstances that, in a sense, we all have collectively experienced. When Grandma first asked me to read this today, I was hesitant. I didn't want to relive this moment. I took some time to consider the fortitude she has shown during this major change in her life and came to the conclusion that I would be remiss to not reflect that same spirit. Many of you knew J.R. Damiani as pastor, Southern gospel singer, and a music enthusiast, and also as friend. A few of us here knew him as dad or father-in-law. Some of us knew him as uncle or brother. A few more of us knew him as grandpa. And one of us knew him as husband of 58 years. I love you, Grandma. While JR will be remembered for all these things and by all of us, each in our own way, I would like to take a few minutes today to remember Pastor JR as my pop-pop and to hold him and honor him the best way that I know how. I have many special memories of pop-pop. He taught me how to rig a fishing line, how to look down a scoop and squeeze, not pull, the trigger just right. The first and only time I ever saw pop-pop run was after a flock of turkey in McConnell's orchard. He did this really cool army dive, took this sniper position, and shot two turkeys in all the excitement instead of just one. It wasn't until after the fact that I learned he actually tripped and fell. I like my version better. Pop-up was there when I shot a high-powered rifle the first time, and despite his clear instruction on how to hold the gun tight into my shoulder, I still ended up with Magnum ring just above my right eye. I suppose that's any young rifle hunter's embarrassing rite of passage. I've kept a voicemail he left me in December 2014. I was up in the mountains hunting alone, and he knew there was snow in the forecast. He wanted me to know where his good spot was and to be safe in the bad weather. Pop-up loved to golf, and because my pop-up loved to golf, I tried to love to golf too. He'd call me par four. I'm technically Nelson the fourth. And he would tell me I had a swing like Tiger. I have my doubts about that, the accuracy of that statement. But it's just one small example of how he had an encouraging spirit. And paired perfectly with that encouraging spirit was his affinity to tease. It's a dominant genetic mutation in the Damiani family. I don't remember how many times I was given the riddle of pinch me and punch me, or how many times he called me horse face. I guess it was... We all had that nickname. If you were ugly, you had that nickname, I guess. When I think back on those times, it is always with a smile on my face. Pop-up was infuriatingly patient. If patience is a virtue, he was our Aristotle. I remember one time in particular, I was in a rush to borrow his Jeep. I'm not even sure if I had his permission. I pulled up the garage door, jumped in the driver's seat, and in my hurry, hadn't noticed the garage door wasn't open all the way. I mangled the door and left a big tear in the soft top. Pop-up's response was, well, I needed a new garage door. And I kind of wanted a new soft top anyway. That's not to say he didn't get angry or upset. I think he did, in his own way. But he was quick to not let the sun set while harboring those feelings. I want to be like that. From the ages of 12 to 16, almost every Sunday at 6:30 a.m., Pop-up would pick me up from my house just a few houses down from his in Waxhaw. We always listened to music on the drive. We would stop at Wawa for donut holes, coffee, and always a treat or breakfast sandwich for me. And Pop-up would always check in on how the cashier was doing. He had a special way of connecting with people. I would spend those mornings learning how to work the soundboard and run lights from Ken Fink. I would intently watch and listen to Ricky Oliveri play drums. I learned to love coffee, black coffee, always black coffee, during these years. I choke it down because that was part of the Sunday morning church ritual. To a small child growing up in this church, Pop-up was bigger than life. He had a proudness in his stride, but each footstep met the floor with humility. It's hard growing up in a pastoral family. There's an unspoken rule of striving for perfection and the stress that comes with living up to people's often unreasonable expectations. Call it naivety or childlike ignorance, but it was and it has continued to be difficult to navigate the dynamics of a family like ours. In spite of church taking precedent and ministry life coming first, I always knew that when I had Pop-up's attention, he was fully present and always willing to help in the best way he knew how. I will forever cherish the private times Pop-up and I shared. When a person like Pop-up passes from this life, there is an inevitable discussion of their legacy. To be candid, I've struggled trying to define what this means to me and speculating about what it may have meant to Papa. I have found some peace in this. A man or woman of God's legacy is not a building or a tax-exempt organization. It is the community they cultivate and the important work they do that the world needs. A parent's legacy isn't the wealth or belongings they leave behind. It is the love they nurture in their children and in their children's children. While many of you may remember JR as pastor of Family Worship Center, I will forever hold him in my thoughts and in my heart as Papa, human extraordinaire.
I'm Morgan, I'm Nelson's wife, and this is Hazel, our daughter. She loved Papa too. So we're gonna sing I'll Fly Away.
Winding down. I'm number four child, so we're getting there. You guys all right? You hanging in? You sure? Okay. You know, you get a one-shot deal remembering the life of someone like my dad, and you guys didn't have to hi, Mia. You guys didn't have to arrive early, set up sound equipment and record table and listen to the rehearsal and then sit through the whole concert and then tear all the equipment down and load it back in the bus and then go out to eat to a restaurant and get home at 2 a.m. when you were six. That was our life for a long time. We did so many concerts and we were just real little. If you go out and look at the record table that's out there, the original table cover is on there. It says Eastman Family. I used to sleep underneath that table at the concerts because it would be a little long. But my kids all want to share something about my dad, so I won't be long, but I'll tell you, Joe mentioned it, a few different people mentioned it. I've known my dad, let's see, I was 51 years when he passed. I never saw him, for real, lose his temper. He never raised his voice at me, ever. What was he like at home? It was true. He was exactly the same way he was here. He never showed a temper. He didn't yell. He never raised his voice. He was always calm. And it was, I think Nelson just said it, his patience was a word he used for it. It was frustrating, what? It was almost frustrating how patient he was. He never got mad. He was so consistent. Unbelievably faithful and consistent to his family, to the Lord, to the gospel. He was a pastor with an evangelist's heart. He loved to share the gospel everywhere he went. He loved to talk to people about sharing the gospel and encouraging people to share the gospel. And he really, truly was that way. I know I have cousins here that, and my Uncle Timmy, that would say he was a father figure to them. I think a lot of people in this room would call him either your best friend or a father figure. And he just was that way because he was so unbelievably consistent and steady, and you could count on him. If there was someone, if you broke down 2 o'clock in the morning and you had to call someone, it was my dad. He was the guy that would answer the phone. If you had to get to the airport, he might have 47 things he had to get done that day, but he would get you to the airport. That's just the way he was. And I do pray that all the family you see represented tonight, that we carry that legacy on, that it all came from the Lord. It's because he surrendered his life to Jesus. Got saved when he was 12 and filled with the Holy Spirit when he was 17, called in the ministry, and he surrendered his life to the Lord, and he meant it, and he lived it. And I love him, I miss him, and like I said, I know he's very happy. It's one thing that I say often. And the second thing I say is I have no regrets, zero, no regrets. I lived with him a lot. We spent a lot of time together. I spent a lot of days, a lot of hours with him, riding around, listening to him. And I tried to be the best son I could, and I have no regrets. I'm thankful for where he is, and I know we're gonna all see him soon. Amen? Hallelujah. Oh, yeah, we're third-generation Pentecostals, so we say, hallelujah, amen, glory. His father was a fireball Pentecostal preacher, amen, Aunt Betty? He was fired up. Aunt Betty can preach, maybe next Sunday. Amen. All right, who's next?
I just jotted down some really quick notes. So when our first daughter was born, Juliana, right there. We could never get her to sleep at night. And I remember many nights JR would come and downstairs and he would rock her to sleep. And sometimes it would take like an hour at a time. And I was so relieved because I was so tired and I was like, oh, thank God, she's gonna help me. And the other thing is when Juliana was about 1 year old, her little shirt tail would hang out of her, like hang down her little onesie that's usually, I wouldn't always snap it. And he would say, I see your tail. And she would say, I have no tail. And he also had this teddy bear that talked, and he would always carry it around the house and he would play with the grandchildren with this teddy bear, and the teddy bear's name was Lefty, or maybe I'm getting mixed up, but I think, was it Lefty? Oh, oh, it was Kate. Gladly the cross-eyed bear. That was really fun too. So, so I remember being at the dinner table, and there was always laughter. Jokes, and what I remember about JR, he was generous, forgiving, non-judgmental, helpful, and he would also give our grandchildren, his grandchildren, our children, he would always give them rides. Anytime, he was always willing to help, like, oh, you need me to pick up your daughter or your son from school? Sure, I'll pick him up or I'll drop him off. And that was always a huge blessing too. He had a great sense of humor. He always sang songs. I remember every single day he wore his cowboy boots because you could hear him walking on the kitchen floor and it would always make that sound. And that's one thing, like the first thing I noticed that was missing was him walking and hearing him walking across the floor. He enjoyed reading, laughing, watching sunsets, and listening to the birds. And last but not least, so if you dropped a little bit of spaghetti sauce on your shirt, that was called an Italian medal. So that's it.
I said that Mia would sit still better if I'm holding her because you're all watching. okay, this is really a little long, but I am not good at impromptu speaking. I just started out the other night thinking about what I wanted to say, and when I'm busy during the day taking care of my kids, I was thinking, I don't know if I'll be able to think of anything because, you know, your mind goes blank when you're busy with other things, but as soon as they were asleep, it seemed like too many things came to my mind. Papa had a whole life before I was born, before we were all born. It's interesting looking at the pictures because we weren't around for any of that, but I still feel like I had a whole life with him. I think he gave all of us a nickname. It probably came from his mom, who gave all of his siblings nicknames, and mine was JR, because my name is Juliana Raquel, and he would always draw out my name in his way and claim me as his namesake, which was special to me, even though JR is not his real name. One thing that I can't get off of my mind, it sounds so simple, but I think for a few months I thought about it every single day, was the way when you walked into a room, into the room that he was in, if he was watching TV, even if it was something that was important to him, maybe something on the news he was waiting to watch until that hour, he would always turn off the TV, no matter what, and always listen to what you had to say. I would always try to argue and tell him that it was fine. He could watch TV. He didn't have to turn it off. I just came to sit with him. But apparently, he knew better than me because I can't stop thinking about that. Mostly when I think about him, I think about the last 10 years or so, because when I was about to turn 13 is when we moved back into Grandma and Pop-Pop's house. So a lot of my memories are from like high school or middle school years, but trying to remember back when I was little, I remember a lot of nights because we lived with my grandparents for the majority of my life, off and on, and I remember laying on the couch with him and laying against his belly and listening to it like make noises. And we would watch Andy Griffith or Mrs. Bucket with Grandma. And I remember the years when we didn't live with them, that it always felt a little strange to me when I would see Grandma and Pop-Pop at church and not having seen them all week, make sure to go and give them a hug, get a mint out of Pop-Pop's pocket, and then beg them and my parents that for me and Bella to be able to sleep over. All of us grandkids, we would sleep in the pull-out couch bed that they had, and Pop-Pop and Grandma would always lay next to us and be patient and spend time reading books and praying with us. He gave us lawnmower rides, Jeep rides, rides in his old collectible cars that I don't remember any of their names, what they're called, but he would tell me all the time. I still feel homesick for Waxhaw after 3 years of being married and having two kids. And I wake up some mornings thinking about being at home in Waxhaw in my bedroom that was between my sister and my grandparents' bedrooms. And I remember as a teenager when I struggled with anxiety or feeling sad, I remember the deep peace and comfort that it brought me, hearing my grandparents already up in the kitchen, knowing grandma was in there stirring her coffee with cream and sugar and pop-up already at the table with his black coffee. I remember all of their habits. I knew his sounds. I could predict when he'd come out of his bedroom or when he wouldn't, the way it sounded when he walked down the hall. Even so closely, I could predict his movements that I could sneak into the bathroom in the morning before I was fully dressed, because I knew so well what he would do or not do. I miss him so much, and I will always remember when I was in Enrique and I's apartment just 6 months ago, and I was getting ready to have our son Alonzo. He was born at home, and my mom coming and telling my midwife that my grandfather was in the hospital, and asking my mom, well, saying to my mom, Pop-Pop's dying, isn't he? And he died 2 days after my son was born. When I was pregnant, he had trouble sometimes remembering when the baby was coming, and we constantly reminded him, but I knew that he was looking forward to meeting him. But I'm glad that one day I know we'll be able to see him again, and he'll be able to meet my son. And thankfully, even though my daughter's only two, she remembers him and asks about him. And he definitely had an affection for her and was always so excited when we came to see her. He would call down the steps if he heard Mia's voice. Is Mia home? Is Mia here? And he'd always want us to come up and visit. When my son was born, when he died, it was especially hard for me because, not me compared to everyone else, but at the time my parents both have had COVID and couldn't come and see us or our baby, and we struggled a lot in the beginning learning to have two kids, and I couldn't gather with anyone when the family was together or be a part of the conversations about when Pop-Pop was in the hospital. So after my son was born, I felt like I could relax a little bit because I was busy preparing for a home birth, and I definitely grieved very hard in the nights when everyone was finally asleep. And thank you everyone for all of your words that you've written on Facebook. I know Facebook is a way to connect us all, and everything that people have written has meant so much to me, and I know other people too in the family. Anyway, sorry, skipping. I'm reminded constantly when I listen to his CD and every time we go in the car that at heart, Pop-Pop was an evangelist. His heart was for souls to be reached for the kingdom of God, and that we would one day be in heaven with him again. And I know that's where he is. He gave me so many things with his generous heart, soft-spoken corrections, his steadfastness that erased all of my fears, his attentiveness, his open heart to other people, no matter how they reacted in return. His way of saying that worrying was useless, his faithfulness to all of us, to God, his calling, and his ministry. Pop-Pop left me so much, and I will always remember. And I love him so much, but I just wanted to leave everyone on a happy note. I'm happy that one day I know we'll be able to see him again. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Enrique. I just want to say something about JR. He accepted me into his family. He treated me like one of his own. He always asked me, how's my family doing? If they need money or if they, he could help me get him them visa so they can come and visit me. He always wanted to come. He really wanted to come to Guatemala with me and stay in the house that I built, even wanted to help me build it. He was so interested in where I come from and wanted to know about me. He always make me feel welcome and wanted, and I'm so blessed and happy that I got the chance to know him for the past 8 years, and I'm always miss him, and I would never met a person like him the way he is.
And this is Enrique, my husband. He forgot to say that.
Yes. Thank you guys for your patience and allowing us to share our hearts. Like, it's just super healing for all of us, and I know it's healing for you guys as well, just to hear about our Pop-Pop, and so many of you were a friend to him and so many other things. So yeah, when I think about my Pop-Pop, the first thing that comes to my mind is his smile and his laugh. When he smiled, it went straight to his eyes, which were always so warm and comforting. His laugh was soothing. Oh my, he loved to laugh. I'm sure all of you could quote at least one or two of his famous jokes. I loved hearing them even after I'd heard them a million times. Another thing that always stood out to me was how he treated people. He was always so loving and kind and patient. When we would go out to eat, he would acknowledge the waitress and often ask if there was something that she wanted us to pray for. He would leave a good tip, smile, and say, God bless you. He was so generous. As I got older, he would ask, how you doing? Do you need anything? Do you need any money? And usually he'd slip me a 20. He paid for everyone's meal every time we went out, and he always was looking out for others' needs. He had this genuine desire for everyone to know Christ. He modeled Christ daily. He was never pushy about his faith, but he never compromised. It was just who he was. It came so naturally to talk about God and the peace that he offers when you believe. If someone didn't agree with him, he was never rude or mean and never said an unkind word about them. The other night, I had a dream that I was back in high school and living with my grandparents again. Sorry. I was frantically getting ready for school, as usual, even in my dream. I can't see. Trying to make the bus. As I was getting ready, I could hear the quiet voices of my grandparents sitting at the kitchen table. When I woke up, I was remembering my dreams. And how also in real life, every single morning, my grandparents would be sitting at the kitchen table early in the morning, drinking their coffee and reading their Bibles or devotionals. My grandma would usually be journaling, and my grandfather might be reading a book. This was something I could always count on. My grandfather would usually yell out how much time I had left and until I would miss my bus. My grandmother would offer to make me breakfast. They would watch for the bus because it would usually pass the house once before coming back to pick me up. They always told me, they were so nice, get to give me extra time. They always told me they loved me, have a good day, and my Pop-Pop would say, remember who you belong to. If my grandfather had to leave before me, he would always kiss my grandma on the lips and tell her he loved her. These are some of my fondest memories. There are so many things that I could say about my pop-pop, but I will end here. I loved him so much, and I know that he loved me. I truly just wanted to make him proud, and I know that he was. Although I miss him, my spirit rejoices knowing he is with Jesus, his very best friend, and the one that he devoted his entire life to. And I know that's where he would want to be. I love you, Papa.
Hello, everyone. I'm Isabella's husband. Me and Isabella are part youth pastors here, Family Worship Center. I was sitting down. I didn't have anything I wanted to say. I just didn't want to force something or write something up. I like being led by the Spirit. And while the Spirit's in here, and like Pastor David said, I sopped it up like a biscuit. And I start moving my thumbs and typing some stuff up, so I'll be really quick. I'm so thankful to know Pastor JR, and I would never have even gotten to really know him without the grace of him and his bride, not only letting his oldest son stay with him, but even me and my wife for a little bit. And so while being in the room next door to him for a couple of months, I can say that all the words that were used to describe this man are true, right? He was real, he was honest, he was loving, a jokester, but consistent. A big thought that has constantly been in my mind over the several weeks is learning the different levels of intimacy that we have here on earth, right? We have physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual. But what I'm coming to learn and understand and grasp more is that the deepest level is spiritual, as it encompasses all of the rest. And with this new enlightened thought, there's one thing that I'm continuing to realize the most. And that is why when someone like JR passes, it's a little difficult. Because he meant more than just the emotions, just the physical memories that we have with him. It was something deeper. And so for me, to know him for that brief amount of time, I saw his character, but I knew him spiritually. And that encompassed a lot of things, right? And so life is not about legacy. But as JR did, it's about living life with a reckless abandon for Jesus. It is the deepest and strongest relationship you'll ever have. And through this connection, I know JR to be a great man and his wife to be a strong woman, on which kept him grounded. And so this is my first Father's Day, as my son is behind me, I think. I didn't have a father growing up, but I always had my grandfather, who is also a pastor, serving in church still. And so I guess maybe that was why I was easily to understand and connect to JR. And I just gravitated toward him and his wife. So yeah, I have stuff written down. I'm gonna finish it. But I don't know, there's something about the head of a family that really touches me differently as grandparents, and so Beverly, I don't know, I just need to tell you that I love you so much. You mean a lot to me, even not knowing you for a little bit, but it's that spiritual aspect, and the whole Damiani family, and everyone here, I'm just happy to know that we can relate deeper on a spiritual level, and that transcends a lot of things. It transcends having time with someone, it can be a day. It can transcend moments, it can transcend everything, even time. It transcends that as we will meet again in eternity. And so as I look on this Father's Day, I think about all the things that I ever wanted in life, and there were only two. One was to be married, and one was to have a son. Those two things have been fulfilled. So beyond all the great things that JR has done and accomplished in his life, when I look at him, I see the thing that sticks out to me is that he was a great man of God, and he was a great father to many people. Happy Father's Day, JR.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Nicholas David Damiani, and I am JR's youngest grandson. Humbly, I come before you to have a serious conversation about someone who is very important to me, about a man who is near and dear to my heart, about somebody who means so much to me that there is not one thing I would not do to see them again, to have at least one last memory with them, and to be with them for all eternity. That man is my grandfather, my father's father, my confidant, my brother in Christ, my best friend, and my sweet, sweet pop-up, Alfredo Francesco Damiani, the second, or junior, also known as Pastor JR. Yes, that's right. My grandfather is the founding pastor of this church family worship center. There is no one like my pop-up. I've never met not one soul who is as kind and gentle-hearted. I have never met anyone who is as generous and so willing to drop everything they are doing in order to lend a helpful hand. Everywhere my grandfather ever went, he was always looking and searching for people he could minister to and tell about Jesus, the only one who can save our soul and set us free so that we can have life and have it abundantly and take part in God's free gift of eternal life. I can't remember the amount of times I watched my grandfather give other people money when they were in a time of need. He always did everything in his power to make sure he put others' needs before his own. My grandfather did not care about money or earthly possessions because there is nothing that can compare to the joy and satisfaction of giving to others and helping people less fortunate than you. He knew that he was rich in love, hope, and faith, and that he had treasures and riches no one could ever imagine waiting for him in heaven. I am so blessed to have been able to live with my grandma and pop-up in their house in Waxhaw for my entire life since I was 4 years old, with my mom, my dad, and my two sisters. I believe God did it on purpose and that it was all part of his plan for my life because living in my grandfather's home has brought me an abundance of joyful memories and life-changing experiences. I'm so beyond thankful and overwhelmed with gratitude towards my grandfather because if it wasn't for him, I would not even be alive. If my grandfather was never born and if he never got married and if he never met my beautiful grandmother, I would never have even been born. And I would not even be able to talk to you today. Not only do I owe my very existence to my grandfather, but he is also the reason that my superhero, David Damiani, is even my dad. Not only do I get to enjoy life because of my pop-up, I also get to have the blessing of being able to say that I have the coolest, strongest, smartest and most encouraging dad in the history of the world. Almost everything in my entire life would not be present if it wasn't for the life of my grandfather. The number one thing in my life to me is God, which includes church, the body of Christ, reading the Bible, preaching the word of God, writing sermons, worship and gospel music, and leading people to Christ. And I owe a lot of that to my grandfather for raising his family in the fear and power of the Lord, which has passed on to me through my dad and my mom. The second most important thing to me in my life is family, and man, do I have a lot of family. I love each and every one of my siblings, aunts and uncles, cousins, second cousins, third cousins, and cousins and cousin-in-laws and all of my family so much. There isn't anything I wouldn't do for them, and the same goes for my pop-up. And if it wasn't for him, I would not have such an amazing family that is always there for me. Some of the best times of my life was spending every holiday and special occasion with my family at my grandfather's house. Last but not least, the third most important thing in my life to me are fellow human beings and making lifelong friends and leading people to Christ. And the truth is, almost every one of my closest friends and brothers or sisters in Christ I met through my grandfather's church, Family Worship Center. So if it wasn't for him, I would not have ever even met most of my best friends who have been with me for my entire life. I will never forget the endless hilarious jokes my grandfather always had in store for any and every situation. And if you were ever feeling down around him, he always knew how to cheer you up and put a smile on your face. Just like my pop-up always had a joke for every situation, he also had a song for every situation. And his singing and his singing voice is always ready to replay in my mind whenever I want to hear him sing again. I miss my pop-up every day, and often I wonder if he is ever looking down from heaven at me. I want to make him proud, and I want to carry on the Damiani legacy in JR fashion. And when my time is up on earth, all I want to hear is the words, "Well done, my good and faithful servant," just like my pop-up did on December 14th, 2020. Jesus told my grandfather he had a call on his life to start a church and be a pastor since he was 17. And just like my pop-up, God told me that I had the same call since I was about 5 years old. I'm going to continue as a fourth generational pastor and preacher traveling the world, spreading the good news of the gospel and the power of the baptism and the Holy Spirit and fire.
Yeah, almost. I'm the youngest of this troupe of JR's kids. As you probably heard already, I'm the child of their old age. My mom and my dad were 39 when I was born. So
they were old.
And now, older. So yeah, I hear a lot of the stories that my siblings tell, and I thought about the fact that they had a very different experience than I did, because they grew up as the quartet, kids of the, a quartet singer and the Eastmen family singers and all that. I grew up here in this building. So my dad was four when I started the church. I was four when my dad started the church, and then 8 or 9 years old when this building was built. So I spent a lot of my time growing up here as the son of Pastor JR, when my siblings spent a lot of their time growing up as the son of a musician and singer and traveler. So I remember have a lot of memories in this building. I remember, first of all, how proud my dad was of this building, of being able to build this. Hi, Mia. I remember the day he actually brought me here, the day that these beams, these big support beams were brought in. You might not know this, but they're all one piece. So this huge thing was driving down Troxel Road to be delivered here. So how many of them? 6 of them, 8 of them, something like that. So he was so proud, and he brought me here to see that, and we spent a lot of time here. I spent my summers in this building. I would throw paper airplanes off the balcony when he was working in the back there, and me and my friend Jeremy would come here and try to compete. And actually, yesterday we were here rehearsing, and I took some of the great-grandkids up to the balcony. We were throwing paper airplanes yesterday, too, just to remember those days. There's something else you probably don't know about this building. If you look up into the center section up there, what you don't know is that is full of pellet gun pellets. Because after a missionette crowning or something that had balloons, the balloons would go up there and get stuck. And the way that my dad got them down was he brought the pellet gun here and he would shoot them down. So there's some lead up there somewhere. But yeah, so I grew up here in this building. I grew up as the son of Pastor JR. I want to share something with you that's a little different, a little odd, but it's really what I want to share. I live in Los Angeles, Pasadena, California, to be specific, and I'm a psychotherapist. So I studied psychology, and I teach psychology at Azusa Pacific University. And so my worldview, the way I see the world, goes through the lens of psychology. I'm not going to psychobabble you to death here, but there's something meaningful that I wanted to talk about. Since Dad died, I've been dreaming a lot about him. And if you know anything about the world of psychology, the dream world is the window into the unconscious, what you're feeling inside, that comes out through your dreams. And I've had a lot of dreams about my dad, and they've all had the same theme. And that is that we, as a family, we're spending time together, and he's with us, but we also know that he had died. So it was after his death, but he's still with us. He's spending time with us. He's hanging out with us. And we kind of know that he's not supposed to be here, but he is. And, my dreams have played out in really odd ways and different ways. I won't share them all with you. But this very distinct feeling that he's with us, but he's not supposed to be. He's already passed on. And I started thinking, what exactly does that mean for me? And I've come to feel that one of the important aspects of losing my dad and thinking about him is the fact that he does live on inside of me. And I know as Christians, we talk about where he is now and how happy he is and he's moved on. But I think it's important, too, for me to remember that he lives inside of me, and I keep him alive through what he taught me, the experiences I've had with him, the memory of him. Along with that, one of the more difficult aspects of my relationship with my dad was having to share him with the church, with the growing church. So I shared him with a lot of you, and that was hard for me. But lately I've been thinking about how much of a blessing that is, because you all carry him with you as well. The legacy that he left is you. And not just because, you know, you came here and you worshiped, but also just what you learned from him, what you heard from him, the experiences you had with him. If he had you at the house, or he took you out to lunch, or he spent time with you, there's a little bit of my dad that lives inside of you as well. And that's an honor, I think, that I have, that we all have, that we get to experience him over and over and over again. Even though he's gone from this world, we can be here and experience that with him. I read today a letter that I had written my dad, actually on Father's Day in 2014. And I don't remember what happened, but we must have had some kind of argument or conversation that didn't go well on the phone. I was living in Los Angeles, obviously, at the time. And I decided to write him a letter for Father's Day. And I said, essentially, I know our conversation didn't go well, and I'm sorry about that. I think he said on the phone that he felt like he maybe made a mistake in raising me. And I wanted to remind him that, no, he didn't, obviously. That even though he and I have had different paths, that I, you know, see the world maybe differently than he did, there's so much of what he taught me that is true, that I work as a psychotherapist. I want to reach people in the same way that he did, but just a different avenue. I want to bring about healing, which is something he cared very much about. He was an empathetic person. Everybody tonight has said how he would make friends of anybody because he was attuned to people. He knew how people felt and how people would react. That's one of the reasons he was so great up here as a pastor and as a singer. Is he would talk to me all the time about reading the crowd. You got to read the crowd. And that's empathy. That's something that I practice every day in the work that I do, because I learned it from him. He could read you. He knew how to reach you. He knew what you needed. He knew how to meet you where you were. That's something that I will forever cherish. And I wanted in that letter to remind him, I am who he made me to be. Even though we think differently and we chose different paths, he lives on inside of me. So that's what I want to share with you tonight. I miss my dad so much. It's kind of been hard to come back here and, you know, go through this again, because we had his funeral back in December and it was a hard, hard time. But it's so great to see you all the people that he has touched and influenced in so many ways. I'm going to sing a song, a hymn that my dad really liked, and actually the first worship album Family Worship Center did, he put this hymn on the album.
Brightly beams our Father's mercy from the lighthouse evermore. But to us he gives the keeping of the lights along the shore. Let the Lord lights be burning, send a gleam across the way. Some poor struggling, a fainting seaman, you may rescue, you may save. Dark the night of sin has settled, loud the angry surges roar. Eager eyes are watching, longing for the lights upon the shore. Let the Lord lights be burning, send the gleam struggling seaman, you may rescue, you may save. I dream your feeble, feeble lamp, my brother, some poor sailor tempest tossed, trying now to make the harbor in the darkness, maybe lost.
You can sing if you know it.
Let the Lord lights be burning, send a gleam across the way. Some poor fainting, a struggling seaman, you may rescue. Struggling seaman, you may rescue, you may save.
Thank you. And now, the wonderful, beautiful Beverly Damiani.
Thank you so much, everyone, for being here. I know it's gotten long, but we're so thankful that we can have the service for my husband and have a memorial for him and share all that he meant to us. And I just appreciate everybody that came. I guess my talk is going to be a little bit different because actually I'm talking to my husband, and you happen to be here. I read something recently. Grief is the last act of love we have to give to those we loved. Where there is deep grief, there is great love. These thoughts might be different tonight, but like I said, they're pointed to my husband. JR, I'm so thankful that God gave you to me and brought us together. He brought you from Lansdale, Pennsylvania, or Waxhaw, to Carbondale, to my church. Where would I be today if I had married someone else? But God saved me for you. We knew immediately that we were attracted to one another when we saw each other. And it didn't take long to fall in love, and 6 months later, we were married. We began our married life together in Waxhaw. You were traveling some with your group, the Eastmen, and worked for your dad in Lansdale as a cobbler, fixing heels and soles during the week and reaching souls through your singing ministry on weekends. We began our little family right away. First Rebecca, or better known as Becky. Then 17 months later came our second daughter, Marie. Then 17 months later, our third daughter, Christina, or Chrissy. 3 years later, we finally got our son, David. And then 10 years later, a surprise boy, Jonathan. I think we did well. God blessed us as we tried to live for him and serve him in our daily life. We dedicated our children and our home to the Lord. God soon blessed us with three wonderful sons-in-law, one daughter-in-law, and 10 grandchildren and 12 great-grandchildren. JR, you know me better than anyone. You knew my idiosyncrasies, my insecurities, but you still loved me. You were a picture to me of the Lord himself. Unconditional love, forgiveness, tenderness, unselfishness, and consistency. I appreciate all the ways you showed your love to me. To name a few, always smelling good. Stetson. Making my coffee in the morning, calling me daily from the office, understanding me, at least trying. You were always kind, thoughtful, and self-sacrificing, thinking of me, buying me gifts, providing me with a home, a car, clothes, and unexpected things like flowers, and placing little items on the pillow, and he always tried to beat me to make the bed first. You had no idea how much that meant to me. You were a thoughtful, kind, loving, spiritual man. You were my friend, my husband, my lover, the spiritual priest of our home, and my pastor. There were times we might have looked back and wished we had done some things differently, but God saw our hearts and he helped us through. You have always been there for our children. The times you traveled with the Eastmen, you were gone days and sometimes week at a time. But when you were home, you always tried to spend quality time with them. You have been a wonderful role model. Your children all thought the world of you and loved when you got one-on-one time with you. You have been a wonderful dad, doing what you could for your children even when they became adults. You did it with no attention or fanfare, just gave, gave, and gave. We traveled down a road that not only helped my love for you to grow, but also for me to grow spiritually. You always kept your eyes on the goal, serving Jesus and following him. Thank you for being the priest of our home. You were gifted to handle many things at a time and kept your cool and Christ-like spirit. Sometimes the ministry gets heavy and wearisome, but because we were partners together, we made it. There are lessons to learn and heavy burdens to bear, but if we draw from the Lord and stay in the Word, he will see us through. Thank you for taking a day and sometimes 2 days for just us. It meant so much to me spending time with just you, getting away from the phone, from daily tasks, and enjoying God's creation together. I loved walking in the woods with you, eating out, taking car rides together, and enjoying the scenery. I am so blessed. And there's a scripture in Song of Solomon 6:3. I am my beloved's and my beloved is mine. Thank you for loving God first and your wife and family second. Your walk with the Lord has kept me on track for sure. You have always tried to please the Lord by admitting your mistakes, humbling yourself, and seeking God's guidance in your personal walk. Sometimes the demands and responsibilities of the ministry are heavy and almost unbearable, but you would always encourage me and carry a part of my load until I could carry it. Thank you for planning vacations for just the two of us. I need you sometimes, just all to myself. It's times like this that I realize how deep our love is for one another and how thankful I am for the Lord, for God reserved you for me. After taking time for us, then I am ready to go back home and share you with others. You're too great to keep to myself. You love to travel, and we often took groups of people with us. We took 3 cruises, 2 to the Caribbean and 1 to Alaska. We went to Hawaii, the quartet conventions, PTL, even leaf peeping. 5 times to Israel and he went 7. And I stayed back so David could go with him. We traveled to many, many states. And he always wanted to go to Italy, but he didn't make it. You wanted to go to a lot of places in the last year, but it just couldn't happen. Folks might say, why are you saying all this now? JR isn't here. Oh, I've told him all these things. You see, I got my material from cards and letters. I wrote him over the years, and I found them all in his office desk. He saved them all. In 2018, we have been through the spring, summer, and fall of our marriage. Now we are living in the winter. No one told us this would be so difficult. Dealing with change, hurts, and pain, trying to prepare for retirement, even though you didn't want to, it was inevitable. It is very hard trying to figure out the future, the things we should do and the things we need to trust God to do. So we walk this last part of our lives together. I pray for your health, your pain, your big decisions, and above all, for your peace and my support always. You deserve much help and happiness for all that you have been to me, our family, and others. How are we to know the future? Only God knows. I only must trust him for our future, for our plans, for the houses, for the church, for our children, and the burdens and trials they carry. I can only pray for God's healing and for wisdom for both of us. Ecclesiastes 1:3 says, who is like the wise man? Who knows the explanation of things? Wisdom brightens a man's face and changes its hard appearance. On September 2nd, 2018, JR's health began to fail. It affected me strongly, and I became depressed. Life was changing for us. He began getting weaker and fought for months by daily going into the office, something he did for 35 years. He stayed pleasant and tried desperately to preach. His passion was souls. Our son David was to be his predecessor. He was, is that the right word? It's hard sometimes to see when you have tears in your eyes. Plus, I don't see good anyway. Anyway, it was a difficult time for both. JR fought hard to keep going, loving his flock and his gospel music and his weekly radio show. He was loved by many, and rightly so. He loved them and did what he could to meet people's needs, if he possibly could. I struggled with his failing health and losing memory. He became weak, and so the children and I decided to take him to the hospital. That was December 2nd, 2020, during the pandemic. We were not allowed to visit him. On the 14th of December, we said that's enough and arranged to go to the hospital to have the different things removed from him, the last being the ventilator. It was a very hard day for all of us. It should not have happened. He went too soon. For 2 years and 3 months, I was in a bad way. I would not go out of the house unless one of my children took me. I stopped driving. I wouldn't answer the phone, especially if it was calls I could not deal with. I was not me. I was full of fear, no peace, no confidence, not living, at least not enjoying living. Being robbed of everything that JR and I had lived for. I did not feel God's presence, and I know his presence was there, but I did not feel it. One night in March, I cried out to God to give me peace, that I would feel his presence again, and that I would be Beverly again. I went through hell these months and days.
I knew there was a heaven and I knew there was a hell. I knew there were demons and I knew there were protective angels. But I wanted peace and I wanted deliverance. I wanted God's presence in my life once again. The next morning I woke up and I was a new person. I was Beverly. And the peace... the peace that passes all understanding. I was a miracle of God's grace and healing. I know everyone here is not feeling God in their life, and if you want it more than anything, he will give it, just like he did me. It is hard to explain, but we know when we have peace and when we don't. He gives us a peace that passes all understanding. I am going to see JR someday with all our loved ones that were gone on before. We will see Jesus, the one who suffered and died on the tree for each and every one of us. I pray that the circle will not be broken, but all will come to him. There was something I saw on Facebook that I jotted down because it just meant something to me. As long as we have memories, yesterday remains. As long as we have hope, tomorrow waits. As long as we have love, today is beautiful. And as long as we have God, anything and everything is possible. I'm just going to leave you with Thessalonians 3:16. Now may the Lord himself, the Lord of peace, pour into you his peace in every circumstance and in every possible way. The Lord's tangible presence be with you all. Thank you.
I have built my life on the solid rock, far away from the sinking sand. And I cast my eyes to the home that waits on the banks of the promissory land. There's a song of praise that is Savior dear, beckoned close. burden's gone. I will